Hey, it's James from Marketing for Restaurants here, and welcome to episode 95 of Secret Sauce, the restaurant marketing podcast, how to get great photos for your restaurant.
Some restaurants are quiet, lose money, and the owner works 70 hours a week. Other restaurants are busy, profitable, and the owners work a few hours a day. What's the difference? They have a secret sauce. Join James from Marketing for Restaurants as he helps you come up with your recipe for restaurant success, your secret sauce.
Hello, everyone. Hope you got a lot out of the restaurant gift certificate episode. I know it's been interesting, some of the emails that we've been getting, people who haven't really been thinking about gift certificates thought that would probably be too difficult, and they're having a crack at using our gift certificate system, which is, of course, free. So some interesting things there, because I think some people didn't really understand some of the economics to come out of gift certificates. There's lots of reasons why you should be thinking about gift certificate marketing. So this is going to be a really interesting episode, I think. Well, I hope it is, because I've got to tell you, as when we're building websites, one of the banes of our life is getting photos from restaurants. And gee, I reckon that we've probably had a website build that's gone on for 18 months. And the two things that always take forever when you're building a website, is there's two things that always slow it up. One, web menu changes. Oh, hang on a sec. We're just changing our menu. Oh, we're working on the new menu. We don't want the website to go live until we've done the new menu. And that menu takes 4 months to get signed off. That happens all the time. And the other thing is we're just waiting on the photos. Well, I've got to tell you, it doesn't have to be that hard. So we're going to go through a lot of things about restaurant photography today. We're going to talk about who can take the photos in your restaurant, what should they be using to get the photos, what to take some photos of, and then we're going to finish up with some great tips to help you get the best photos possible for your, well, partially for your website, but for all of the other things that you want to use the photos for. Now, before we get too excited about restaurant photography, I thought I'd share a little story about a cunning marketing idea that one of the team came up with a couple of weeks ago for one of our customers. Well, in fact, it was about a month ago now. So we're helping a customer out with their marketing. And one of the things that we were discussing is, you know, how is the business going? What do you see as the weaknesses in it? And one of the things that they were really struggling with was getting customers in early in the day. So, you know, they're thinking about breakfast, they're thinking about coffee maybe. And so we decided on an interesting way of doing things. What we did was we declared happy hour. So we offered a discount for anyone who came in between 9 and 11. Now, this is what I would call an unsophisticated Facebook campaign. Unsophisticated in that there was no real tracking of it. Now, so why did we do that? Because as you know, I'm one of these people who loves to know when something has worked and when something hasn't worked. Well, there was no electronic, there was no automatic tracking of it. The tracking occurred though, because you had to say, oh, I'd like to come in for the happy hour deal. Now, they had at least one customer a day coming in asking for the happy hour deal. This is between 9 and 11. So, you know, generally pretty quiet for a lot of people. These guys are Monday to Friday as well. Much, much stronger later in the day. They build up to quite a busy time at night, but had struggled for customers around breakfast time. And so this happy hour concept worked really well. And they said, we just had a catch up with them, and they said, I asked the question, how is it actually running? And she said, you know what? It's been really amazing. We've had at least one a day and sometimes quite a few more coming in saying, I'm here for the happy hour deal. So what did I like about that? So firstly, we've taken something that happy hour has been around for a long, long time. And as I've always said, it doesn't need to be just around alcohol or drinks. You know, you can also have the happy hour menu out there as well. You know, something that's quick and easy for the kitchen to prepare. Because, you know, they're prepping for a big dinner. That's generally why you have happy hour. Well, the other thing, of course, is to get people in so that the place looks busy. So as people are walking by at 7 o'clock, they can say, oh, wow, look at this place. It's half full and the other place is empty. Well, that's because the people are in there having happy hour. Now, they're not going to notice that these people are happy hour customers just about to leave. they're thinking that they're there for the big dinner. They go in, they get the big dinner. And, you know, a lot of people have said to me, you know, that first customer on the night when you're relying on walk-by traffic can be the hardest one to get. And if you don't get that first one, then you've had a night where you've had no one turn up, and that's a real disaster. Happy Hour can really help with that. This wasn't used for that. This was to use to drive people who, you know what? This is a Facebook campaign that was run. I think the budget for it was $2 a day. If it wasn't, then it would have been $3. Certainly wasn't throwing a large amount of cash at it. But just something a little bit different to drive people to have a think about coming in the morning. And these people who generally wouldn't have come in the morning. We did a little bit of demographic targeting. We were targeting more females. I think it was only females, actually, for this. There was a great photo. Obviously gets interest in the Facebook feed. People see happy hour. Then they see that it's in the morning. It's like, oh, you know what? That's unusual. And that worked all the way, because it's actually quite difficult to get people to they're actually changing their behavior. Then they're coming in. Then they've got to mention it. Oh, I'm here for the happy hour deal. But, you know, worked a treat. A high ROI Facebook campaign. So something to have a think about. Now, on to restaurant photography. I'm really passionate and excited about that, about this, for a couple of reasons. Firstly, the old saying, a picture tells 1,000 words. So many people in their restaurants put so much effort into all of the things that they're doing. They're sourcing great produce, they're hiring awesome people, they're creating amazing experiences, they're creating amazing dishes, and yet that story is really difficult to get out of them. And a photograph or a series of photos can do such a good job of telling that story. And, you know, I find it always interesting, because when you go through the psychological process of why someone booked in a restaurant or why someone has gone to that place, there's a whole heap of questions. And, you know, I've spoken about it before. I want to de-risk this transaction. Restaurant owners, you live in your restaurant, so you know intimately what is going on in your restaurant. But for someone who's never heard of your restaurant before, they don't. So there is a lot of risk. It's not like this is word of mouth. It's not like, you know, their best friend has said, you've got to go to this restaurant because they've got the best burgers, best vindaloo, best ice cream cake, best whatever it is. That's not on the table. So people are going to be wondering, well, I wonder what the place looks like inside. I wonder how expensive it is. I wonder if the food's any good. Photos are really powerful in getting that message across. So if you've gone to all of that effort to create an amazing food, amazing restaurant, amazing ambiance, amazing food, amazing experiences, don't you think you need a couple of amazing photos to get that message across? Now, when I've said that, everyone assumes that, you know, I'm saying, well, let's get a professional photographer in. Hold your horses there. So the first thing that we want to talk about is who's going to take the photos. And you know what? If you get a professional photographer, then I think that's fantastic. A professional photographer will take better photos than you. Highly likely. If they don't, you've probably got the wrong professional photographer. Because I've been on photo shoots, and then, you know, 2 weeks later, the photographer sends a link to all of the photos, and it's like, are these at the restaurant? Like, I don't even recognize the place. I don't recognize the food. This looks amazing. Absolutely amazing. So there is a lot of skill that a good professional photographer will have. And so my default setting, I never push this, but my default setting is if there's a professional photographer there, then that's epic. That's really exciting. But, you know, it comes with a cost. And so one of the things that I like to do when we're dealing with professional photographers is really, really, really work on the brief. So one of the things that I've seen happen, and this actually happens quite a bit when we're doing a website and someone says, oh, and I've got professional photos. And it's like, okay, great. What story is it that we've told with, you know, how is this sort of building? What are we going to use these photos for? When you've got a professional photographer coming in, you want to think about the brief. Because what I would like to do is I would like to use the photos that you've got from that one photo shoot for the next 12 months worth of marketing. So what you need to do is you need to go back to your annual marketing plan. You've got one of those, haven't you? You need to go back to your annual marketing plan and say, right, we've got this, and this campaigns that we want to run. We're going to be sending out these emails. We're going to be running these offers. We want to change the revenue mix for the restaurant by doing this, this, and this. We want to increase our beverage sales by doing that, that, and that. So all of these sort of things need to be factored into the brief. Because too often, and I've seen it where they'll say, yep, we've got some professional photos that have been taken, and there will be 20 shots of food. And it's like, okay, but aren't you from Sicily? And aren't you accredited to build, to create pizzas using a special kind of dough? And where's the picture of you? Where's the picture of the dough? Where's the picture of you making the dough? Oh, I didn't think of that. I didn't think anyone would want to see that. And it's like, well, that's a really big part of the story. Where's the picture of the restaurant? Now, one of the issues that we see, and this happened, and look, we've been guilty of this as well, because it is quite difficult to manage, and which is why we've got, I'm thinking that professional photographers are an answer for a lot of the questions. They're not an answer for all of the questions. You create an image, you take the photo of what the restaurant looks like, and it's beautiful. You know, they'll work with the color, they'll work with the saturation, the lighting, all of those sort of things. You know, they'll have really powerful flash, and they'll have things that are going to bounce the flash off all over the place. They'll be really thinking about how shadow is going to play out, all of those sort of things. The only problem is a lot of the time these photo shoots are done when the restaurant is completely empty. And you know, I think deep down, chefs like that empty image of because it's the calm before the storm, and it looks, everything looks in its place, everything's laid out, the cutlery's all nice, and everything's clean. But you know what? That's what I never sell that. McDonald's sell a clean restaurant. You don't need to. We want people having fun. So that's one of the things that you need to be thinking about is, can you get your photographer to come in for half an hour when the place is really busy? Possibly not, you know, because you want to spend some good time cooking up the meals individually so that, and then he'll spend, and you know what, you can never eat the food after the shoot because it'll have been like 45 minutes that the guy will be like trying it one way, trying it the other way, trying the lighting, all of the variations of it. The food's always cold by the time it finishes. So of the things that you can do, what is your 12-month plan going to be like? Are there photos of you? Are there photos of your team members? Are there photos of the produce that you're going to be getting in? People in the kitchen. One of the important things that we always talk about when we're doing niche marketing is if you're doing gluten-free, you know, a lot of restaurants will have a specific gluten-free part of the kitchen. Take a photo of that. In my mind, the industry best practice gluten-free page is a photo of the area that you've got specially put aside, and you know, gluten-free, there's a little sign there that says that, and then your signature gluten-free dish. And then, you know, you can do some search engine optimization around telling that story. That sells though. When someone shows that you've got the taken the care and attention to actually have a gluten-free area and that you've got a decent gluten-free meal, anyone with celiac disease is going to go for that. So you need to be thinking about the kind of marketing that you want to be doing. Your Facebook marketing out for the next 6 months, what are the campaigns that you're going to do? It's pretty easy to do. You know, you might have a look at your international observances list. So at the moment, we just had World Coffee Day. Now, 3 months ago, you could have looked in that list and said, oh, wow, World Coffee Day is coming up. Let's have a photo of one of our awesome baristas making a coffee. You know, there's lots of things that you can do. And here we are with the fresh beans. We get our beans sourced, ethically sourced. It's really smooth. We believe it's one of the smoothest coffees in town. Come along and try it. Meet our team of baristas. Blah, 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 blah. This stuff just writes itself. There's three or four photo ideas that you could run. And of course, with Facebook, you might want to run those three different ones because some of them will get different engagement. And don't forget, if someone sees that photo that aligns you with coffee three or four times, that's a pretty powerful message. So there's a few things that you want to be thinking about. And that's why the brief is really important. Making sure that you put some thought in before the photographer gets there, because this happens all the time. Oh, great. We're so glad that you're here. And now the photographer, if the photographer's good, he's going to be saying, let's do a photo of this. Let's do a photo of that. But I think that you really need to be driving it. He's not going to know that you're really keen. You see a big opportunity in growing coffee sales in the morning and that you've got specially trained baristas and ethically sourced coffee. He's not going to know any of that. So he's never going to say, you know, let's take a few coffee photos. You need to be driving that. And one of the things that I like to do is a couple of weeks out, I'll say, you know what? Hey, let's think about this, 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 and this. Are there any other ideas that you've got? This is a bit of the story about the restaurant. This is the owner who you'll meet on the day. The thing that makes him special is this, this, and this. I try and put him into the picture as much as I can because you know what? He'll have some downtime and he'll be thinking about the jobs that he's got coming up. Some creative idea might come in. If you hit him with, oh, this is what's happening, but of course we've only got 4 hours, so we need to move really quickly. No one can be creative in that kind of environment. Well, I mean, some people can, the really good people can. I can't. Most of my crazy ideas come to me when it's in that downtime. So that's the first thing. If you're using a professional photographer, make sure that you have a good brief for them. Now, professional photographers, that's the best thing that you can do. A lot of people are going, wow, you know what? We don't have the money to spend on a professional photographer. So, and this is one of my favorite ideas, and I know it's a favorite of a lot of our customers. What about student photographers? Now, the thing that makes a professional photographer is he's probably got a great camera and he's got a lot of theory behind how to take photos and he'll have experience. He'll have taken, if he's a food photographer, he's probably taken 100 pizza photo shoots. So you know what? He knows how to take a photo of a pizza. If you get a student photographer to come in, they're probably going to have great equipment. They're probably going to have a lot of the theory behind them. They're just not going to have the experience. Now, and this is one of those transactions that's really interesting. What they're looking for is practice in interacting with a real live customer. You can give that to them. So what we've done is we've got our customers to reach out to the local photography school and said, look, you know, we need someone to take some photos. So we're offering a free meal for someone who can take some photos for us. A lot of schools love this because they're like, oh, you know, and we really want our students to go out and actually do some commercial photography. Now, they're still students, so there's no expectation of them being paid. You throw in the food that you're going to cook for them, and it works really well. This would be the second kind of person who can take the photos for you, a student photographer. Have a look at the places that are teaching photography and reach out to them. And you know what? You can get this done every 6 months because you think about it. They're going to be having classes coming through all the time. You may even get multiple students coming in at the same time. There's lots of room to play here. And they will, in general, take a better photo than what you or the other groups that we're going to talk about are going to take. But probably not as good as your professional photographer. So next on our list is your guests. And you know what? If you're slanted towards the kind of modern online marketed type restaurant, which is incredibly popular these days, then one of the success metrics will be the number of people who are taking photos of your food. These people are taking photos of your food anyway. So one of the things that I've seen is, you know, take a photo of our food and tag us in on it and we'll give you a discount. Or go in the best photo of our insert dish here, will receive a $50 gift voucher to come back or any other incentive for them to tag you in. Or just when people tag themselves in a post, when they check in and then put the image up there, ask them if you can use it. That's a great photo. Do you mind if we use it? Most of the time, people are going to be really happy with that. One of the things that I see is really interesting is, and I actually spoke to a restaurant owner who said that he deliberately made it dark in the dining room so that people couldn't take photos because he was sick and tired of people taking crappy photos of his food. You know, he said, I put so much effort in. There's 20 years worth of experience here and they're going to take a crappy photo, put it up on Facebook and you just think, who would eat that? Well, you know what? I personally think, that's the exact opposite of what you should be doing. I've also been in restaurants where people say, oh, you're taking a photo of the food. Do you want an extra light? And they'll bring a portable light so that the food looks immaculately lit up. And it's like, wow, you got this really strong light source. There's shadow. There's all sorts of this adds to the drama of this awesome dish. That's amazing. So there's a couple of ways that you can do it. But I think, and we're going to talk about lighting when we talk about the tips, but definitely don't discount your guests. And I've seen this where, you know, someone will bring in a professional camera and spend an hour or two taking photos for you in return for a meal. This is a guest, so not a student. There's plenty of ways that you can incentivize your guests to take some photos. Now, probably the most important group, I think, is your staff. your staff should be taking photos. Now, so even if you've got the professional photographer to come in, he's not going to be there for everyone's birthday party. He's not going to be there when a celebrity comes in. He's not going to be there when something epic happens in the kitchen. Your staff will be there. They are there all the time. And this is why I think you need to be empowering your staff to take a photo. Let them know that it's okay to take the photo. Give them some tips. Give them some education on how to take photos. And of course, you know, let them know the kind of situations that you're looking for. One of the things that I find, you know, if you've got 5 or 10 people in your team, there'll be someone who likes taking photos and will actually, they'll feel empowered. Their job satisfaction goes up because it's like, you know what? I took this photo and then we used it on Facebook and it got, you know, 50 likes, 100 likes, 1,000 likes. But that was my photo and I'm really proud of that. So you can actually provide a little bit of job satisfaction by empowering your team to take the photos. Now, lastly, but not least, you. And I know what you're saying. Oh, James, I'm working 70 hours a week. Do you think I've got time to be taking photos? Well, and look, I'm really big on, hey, do you really need to do that? Can't you get someone else to do it? But, so I'm the boss of marketing for restaurants. I've got lots of work. I work really long hours. But still, I'm the chief photographer within the organization because photography for us is very important. Getting that right image to go along with a blog article, getting the right image to go along with a Facebook post, getting that right image to tell the story of a podcast, that is really important. We try and disseminate the business plan and what it is that we're doing to everyone in the team, but it's up in my noggin and that's what it's my job to worry about. So I'll often see things that the other guys don't see and you will be exactly the same. This is why I spend time learning some of the techniques that you can use to take great photos because of the fact that in my mind, I've got a marketing campaign that I want to execute. I know the shot that I want. And I think that linking the person who's going to take the photo with the person who's going to be executing the marketing campaign with the person whose business it is, that can be a really powerful thing. Yes, we're all really busy, but hey, I think it's where there's some really high return on investment stuff that can happen when you get that right. So the next question that we want to cover is what to use. And so first off, great cameras take great photos. And so there's a lot to be said for a great digital SLR. Some of the best photos that I've ever taken, I've been taken with my Olympus OMD 4/3 system. An epic digital SLR, very powerful zoom lenses on it. You can take some really, really amazing photos with it. I've got to say though, I don't think I've taken a photo with it in probably the last 3 years. And that's really an interesting story because every time I went to a restaurant, I was that guy who had the big camera bag and it was just like, oh God, that guy. And it's painful. It's annoying, particularly when you're traveling. It means that it's one extra bag that you've got to take, which is really problematic. And so I then got a Sony DSC HX90V, a little compact camera. And this camera has taken some absolutely amazing photos. If you've seen the photos from when we went to dinner by Heston, pretty sure they were taken with that. Now, interestingly enough, I think that was the last time I used that camera because every photo I've taken since then has been on my Galaxy S9. The camera on that is amazing. Now, I don't want to get into an iPhone versus Samsung type of scenario. You know what? Your mobile phone. Your S8, you know, it doesn't even need to be the current model. The phones now are amazing. And in my research for this podcast, I was reading a couple of articles by professional photographers. And one of them said that when he bought his phone, he felt that he bought a camera with a phone built in. He said that the ability with it, the lens, all of those sort of things made it absolutely an amazing piece of technology. Now, the really cool thing about this is that this piece of technology is sitting in your pocket right now, probably, as you're listening to this, and you're probably listening to it on your phone. How cool is that? But it really does give you a huge advantage because that phone is with you. It's with you all the time. So whenever something is happening, you're able to take a photo of it. as you develop your eye, you're going to start looking at things in a different way and you're going to think, you know what, that would make a great photo, or I could use that perspective to take a great photo. You can then, and it's interesting because today I was walking by the office, we had the blinds down, at the top of the blinds there's a gap, and that was illuminating our Iron Man statue. I took a photo of that with some stuff on it, and that is now a marketing piece. It was just something that I happened to catch my eye as I was walking past it. These are the kind of things that are going to happen for you in your restaurant, and these are the kind of opportunities that you want to be able to seize. You want to be able to grab it, and that's why I think that with your mobile phone, there's no reason why you can't be taking great photos. We've built amazing looking websites with photos that have been turned around in under 24 hours by a restaurant owner. And it's like, you know, take a photo of this, you know, take a photo of that. And we want to be able to do this as well. It makes it so much easier when you're able to quickly take a couple of photos that you need. And the quality is just amazing. There really is no excuse. And the thing that I find really amazing is that as I was doing a little bit of research for this, I looked up Tangerine. Now, we've spoken about the movie Tangerine before. It was featured in the 2015 Sundance Film Festival. And the thing that was, and it looked, evidently it was a pretty good movie. That's neither here nor there. The thing that was amazing about it was entirely filmed on an iPhone 5S. Now, there's a few years that have gone under the bridge since 2015. So that just shows you, if you can use a phone that's a couple of models old and be able to shoot a full-featured film, what is there that you can do in your kitchen today with your mobile phone? And it's not just taking photos. Of course, we're always talking about video, 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 video. You want to be taking video. How hard is it to take video? Well, it's not that hard. How hard is it to do hyperlapse or time-lapse? It's not that hard. There's lots of things that you can do with your mobile phone that are going to help you market your restaurant. I think that's really, really cool. And I think that, you know, one of the things that we do assessments for people's websites all the time, you know, we'll have a look at them and we'll go through it and you know, basically say, here are the improvements that need to be made on your website. The number of times that we go, that photo does not make me want to eat in that restaurant, or there isn't a photo of this, or all of these photos are just garbage. What the hell's going on here? I think probably 15% of the websites that we see are of the level where when you see that, you're like, well, I don't want to eat there. And that's not on the list. We're not eating there. I'll tell you that much. I don't know where we're eating tonight, but I'll tell you this much. We're not eating at that place because that food looks like garbage. Now, these are people who, now, I don't know, some, it might be a great restaurant. It might not be a great restaurant, but they're certainly leaving no room for doubt that the presentation that they're putting forward, the story that they're telling, is one of a restaurant that is really struggling. We all know that restaurant. We've all eaten in that restaurant. You may own that restaurant, God forbid. I hope that isn't the case for you. And if you do own that restaurant, then there's a lot of things that you've got to work on. Work on those things first. Once you've turned all of that around, don't forget, please, 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 please don't forget to fix the story that you tell on your website. Because once you fix the other things, once you fix the kitchen, once you fix the menu, once you fix the team, then you've got to fix the story that you tell about that. Because when I'm in a strange country or a strange city, I'll try and go to one of our customers. And if we haven't got any customers in the area, then I'll go to one of the prospects, you know, just to sort of check them out. And you know, I've been to restaurants and you think, yeah, I'm going to go to this place. It's going to be one of those meals, you know, definitely one that we're not going to be telling people about. And you go in there, and it's like, wow, this is amazing. And the thing is, I've judged that on the website or their Facebook, you know, I've judged them from all of the storytelling that they're doing. And that storytelling is garbage. And then, you know, go, wow, this meal was really amazing. This is really exciting. And, you know, the restaurant's a quarter full or I'm the only person in there. And they go, oh, wow, what did you like about it? And you start telling them, they go, well, you know, that's because, and then all of a sudden this whole story just comes tumbling out. And the sad thing is that I only went there because, you know, they were on a marketing list somewhere, you know, they'd signed up for a product 12 months ago and never used it. And I just wanted to go out and see them. We didn't know them from a bar of soap, but I would have never gone there had I looked at their website. Now, I hope you don't have one of those websites, but really, there is no excuse for not having some great photos to help tell the story about your great restaurant. So next week, we are going to look at the kind of top photos that you should be taking. What are the kind of things that you want to be taking a photo of and how are you going to use them? Then we're going to go through 17 tips to help you take better photos for your restaurant. Hopefully this has inspired you to take some photos. Tag us in on Facebook or LinkedIn with the photos that you're taking. That would be really, really great. Apart from that, you go out there and you have a really busy week. Bye.
Want more customers for your restaurant, cafe, or takeout? Every month, our marketing tools and information are used by thousands of restaurant owners just like you to help them find more customers and turn them into repeat customers. All of our tools and information is designed specifically for restaurant owners. We know you don't have a lot of time to spend marketing or learning complicated procedures, so our tools are quick and easy to use. If you're looking to increase your revenue and profits or want to work less hours, check out marketingforrestaurants.com.